In today's video, we're going to explore whether or not high ISO or underexposure causes noise. Welcome back, everyone. If you could please like and subscribe, I would really appreciate it. So I started off as a photographer back when we were still shooting film, and then I started that transition at the very beginning of the digital era from film to digital. Now with film, if you went from 100 ISO to 200 ISO, it was a big difference. And when you went up to 800 ISO, it basically looked like sandpaper. And then as we got those first digital cameras, as we started off coming off of the base ISO, I even think some of them the base ISO was 200. I don't think it went all the way down to 100, but as we started to increase the ISO, all of a sudden there were a lot of artifacts, sort of little gray specks, and of course, color noise in the images. And so I've always been very cautious about increasing my ISO. And maybe it's PTSD from those early years, or maybe it's for a good reason. So in today's video, I want to explore whether or not increasing my ISO in the studio is something that's okay, or maybe it's a bad idea. So in today's test, just right off the bat, I want to let you know that I'm going to be shooting at 100, 200, 400, and 800 ISO. The reason I'm not going beyond 800 ISO is because I don't think that would be very useful in a studio environment. I'm sure there are plenty of videos on YouTube about shooting at very high ISOs. I just want to focus on the ISOs that would be practical to use in a studio environment. Because we are creating our own light most of the time, we can definitely achieve an exposure at 800 ISO. And in addition to that, if we start going too high in our ISO or our gain in video speak, we're gonna end up in a territory where we're mixing available light and flash, and that could lead to all sorts of color contamination issues. So I just wanna keep it sort of a little more controlled in those more usable studio ISOs. So for this test with our model Jordan, I created a fairly high contrast situation by using multiple hard lights. And then I used a V-flat world V-flat in front of him in this sort of table position in order to bounce that light back up in to the shadows. Now this should give us a lot of dynamic range in the shot, and we should be able to see some fairly deep dark colors and some good brighter colors as well. But I've also created a gradient on the background, and in many cases, you're gonna start to see noise in these sort of transition areas between dark tones and mid-tones, so this background will be a good choice as well. I intended maybe for this shot to be in black and white, but for the purposes of this video today, we're gonna be looking at it in color, because if it's in black and white, you won't see those color artifacts or noise coming into the frame. So the very first thing I'm gonna do in Capture One is go in and turn off the default denoising processing. So you're just gonna see the raw noise from the camera. In each one of these tests, I'm going to overexpose the shoot or the shot by one stop, and that'll be on the left. And then in the middle, you're gonna be looking at the correct exposure. And then on the right, you're gonna look at exposure that's one stop under, and both the underexposure and the overexposure have been corrected so that we're looking at the same brightness on the screen left to right. So now looking in at 100 ISO at all three images, things appear to be super clean. At 200 ISO, looking at the close-up of his neck in the negative one image here on your right, I see a fair amount of noise. And then as we go up to the top left corner, I see some noise as well. In the 400 ISO images here, now looking at his neck in the correct exposed image, I do see some noise, and it's not that bad, but there is a lot more noticeable noise in the negative one frame. Now in the top left-hand corner, it's clean in the overexposed image here on your left, and there's a little bit of noise in the properly exposed image and a lot of noise in the underexposed image. Now looking at the 800 ISO image, there is a fair amount of noise here on his neck in the correct exposed image in the middle, and there is of course more noise in the underexposed image on the right. And now looking at the top left-hand corner at 200%, the plus one image looks okay, but the other two images do have noticeable noise. Now if I turn the standard noise processing that Capture One has back on and we look at these images, at 200 ISO, looking here at the top of the frame now, the one-stop under frame on the right does not look bad at all. At 400 ISO, the neck in the one-stop underexposed image does have some noise there in the transition area between the shadow from the collar and the mid-tone. And at 400 ISO here at the top, I do see some blocking in the correct exposed image, and it's far more noticeable in the one-stop underexposed image on the right. And now looking at his neck at 800 ISO, there is some noise in the correct exposed image, and there is also some noticeable noise on the one-stop underexposed image. In fact, it has sort of a green undertone as well, caused by that color noise. Now looking at the top left corner, the one-stop overexposed image looks fairly clean, but there is some blocking in the correct exposed image here in the middle, and there is a lot of blocking in the one-stop underexposed image on the right. Now let's compare the images that have no noise filtering with the images with the standard noise filtering as well. Now looking at 200 ISO, the top left of all of the images are improved with the noise filtering, and the correct exposure looks good, and the negative one image becomes usable. At 100%, the neck is a lot cleaner with the noise filtering, but it's not that noticeable. And at 400 ISO here at the top, I do see some blocking in the one-stop underexposed image on the right. So I think the takeaway here is it's okay if you use up to 400 ISO so long as you expose to the right. And expose to the right is a phrase people use when they're talking about a slight overexposure, because doing so causes the histogram on the back of the camera or in Lightroom or Capture One to lean to the right. And then of course if you use the standard noise processing, you'll be in really good shape. But also, if you just shot at 200 ISO and maybe you weren't so accurate on your exposure, you would be okay as well, so long as the noise filtering was turned on. So for this second setup, I've created a very soft light, or I've made very soft light on the set. So I've put a large light source above and it's pointed down. And the reason for this is I want to create very subtle shadows between the midtones, very subtle differences between the midtones and the shadows. So this should be a very different light setup than what we had before, and maybe we'll learn something different. Now, in that first setup, because I was limited and I couldn't turn the hair light down anymore, I could only give you a one-stop underexposure. In this test, however, for the most part, I'm gonna give you a two-stop underexposure. I should say I'm gonna give you one-stop over on your left, then I'm gonna give you the correct exposure in the second position, then one from the right is gonna be one-stop under, and then on the right will be two stops under, except for in one incident, and that was when I was shooting 100 ISO, I accidentally shot three stops under instead of two stops under. And in all of these examples, you're going to see them with the noise processing turned off. So zooming in here at 100% at 100 ISO on his neck, you can see a fair amount of noise start to appear in the three stop underexposed image. At 200 ISO, looking at the same area, you're gonna see noise start to appear at one stop under, and you're gonna see more of it in there at two stops under. At 400 ISO and zooming in on his neck, there might be noise here in the correct exposure. You're gonna see it in the negative one exposure, and of course you're gonna see more of it in the negative two exposure. at 800 ISO. I think there is also noise here in the correct exposure, and of course, more of it at -1 and more of it at -2. I think the key takeaway here from the second look is that if you want to find the noise, you're going to have to find the shadows. And if you've got a fairly subtly lit scene without a lot of super dark areas, you're not going to necessarily have a lot of noise. So for the main takeaway for this test, we're going to have to rely more heavily on that first experiment that we did with Jordan, because there were a lot of nice shadows. I think it's going to be perfectly safe with the noise processing turned on to shoot at 100 ISO all of the time. Well, of course, that's what I've been doing forever. At 200 ISO, I think it's fine as well. You can make some exposure mistakes and still recover from it. But if you're shooting at 400 ISO and you don't expose to the right, you could end up in trouble, which is why I'm probably not going to shoot at 400 unless I really have to. You know, the other big question is, does high ISO or underexposure cause noise? And for right now, given the results of this test, I would lean more towards the underexposure, but I would say it's a little bit of both. Anyway, guys, I hope that helped and made sense. I know it's gonna help me in the future know that I can feel a little more comfortable going up a little higher on that dial in the studio. Thank you so much for your time. Stay safe, have a great day, and I'll talk to you soon.